All right, welcome everyone. It's nice to be back in front of the camera. It has been some time, but as the saying goes, better late than never. Speaking of late, I don't think it's late. I think it's kind of early, which is a good thing because getting the head start as far as customs broker preparation for next coming examination, which is the April 2017 examination, is the better you start, the better in shape you will be. So this time the goal is to make a presentation available, and the presentation in such a way where you where it is able to reach many viewers in a live mode. I think the technology is right about up there. I have been reaching out to the audience through the YouTube channel. I have been reaching out through the other platforms, such as the Vimeo platform, through the books. I think now, and also live, of course, going, making a class attendance, going to classrooms and making lectures that way. But I think the time has come to experiment a little bit with a more live stream. And since I believe the technology has gotten up there, I think it will be a good experiment to do that. And again, this is only an experiment, so we'll see how it goes. But given the initial tests which we've conducted over the summer, I think it's gonna go pretty well. If it doesn't, it doesn't. But I think it's worth a try. So, what's going on? Starting November 15th, 2016, we're going to do some live classes, right? And they're gonna be live, meaning it can be accessed online through the live stream, and it can be accessed in person, all right? So what's the goal of those classes? Well, just like any other class, the goal is to prepare folks to pass the customs broker exam. And the methodology of Law Customs School has been in an integrated type of way where I come out, I make a presentation on a particular topic, and we go topic by topic, and the ultimate compilation of those topics came out to be called what I like to call a textbook, which is those. It used to be one volume, now it's grown up to be two volumes. And those textbooks are broken down into the separate topics. So you have introduction, you have charts, you have general provisions, terms, classification, etc., etc. As you go down the list, the things, I attempt to make things more complicated and more sophisticated. This, then you have a verb supplement for each chapter, and some chapters. Let me take that back. Some chapters may not have verb supplements. Most of them do. I think about one or two chapters do not have verb supplements. But So those verb supplements. Those verb supplements. What they designed to do is they designed to give you whatever is written in a chapter of this book, and put it in the context. So in other words, what has been happening is someone like me would come out and try to digest whatever is written in the chapter. So it kind of makes sense. So instead of like one sentence, Code of Federal Regulations, in the introduction section, which will be which we will talk about on November 15th. What I will do is I kind of like expand it and extrapolate it and put it in the context where it fits as far as the our nation's or the United States legal system, how they're being promulgated, what is the relationship, for example, to the harmonized tariff schedule of the United States, how do they interact, and how are they administered throughout the country by, in this case, since we're dealing with Title 19, by U.S. Customs and Border Protection. All right, so that's the presentation part. Then there is a Q&A part, more of Q than A, rather, where what we've done is we've taken all the past exams and we took all the relevant questions and we put them in the context. We put them in the context of, for example, of introduction, the questions that deal, for example, with particular knowledge, basic knowledge of the regulatory text, which has been tested, or such as classification related to commingling, such as importer security filing, rail and truck arrivals. How did customs test on this particular topic in the past? So you kind of like, you have the basic text. Well, it may not be so basic, but you kind of have a text in the book. Then in the web supplement gives you a lecture, kind of like in the same format like the one I'm standing and speaking right now. And then there is questions that's designed to solidify your knowledge. In addition to that, there is also what's often included what's called supplemental reading, and those can be CBP, Customs and Border Protection literature. It can be court cases, it can be directives, it can be other relevant stuff, which may not necessarily be essential for passing customs broker exam, but they definitely help you to understand what's going on. So that's the goal. And going back to the live classes page, so we're at here. Let me say a few words about how those live classes will be conducted. So, first of all, let me jump to the syllabus, because it's kind of important to understand what would be agenda of the day, if you will. So, first of all, the agenda is not rigid. Over years of teaching, of preparing to conduct this type of classes, I learned that it's very good idea to have a plan in mind. And this plan is kind of like laid out over here. But over the years, I learned that it's best to be flexible, because oftentimes, almost as often as you are you dedicate yourself to particular topic, other questions arise. So, and again, this is encouraged, because when other questions arise, you kind of see interrelationship between this topic and this topic and other topics, and you kind of starting to get a grasp of big picture. Additionally, the detours from the subject are also good enough. I think should be welcomed, because, for example, while you speak in terms of country of origin, as an example, you also may deal with questions of classification. So you have a regulatory text, which is Code of Federal Regulations, and you have harmonized tariff schedule, which is a statute, but it basically deals with classification issues. And jumping back and forth, or sometimes sidestepping, or taking what I like to call a break, sometimes I call it a quiz break, simply because we break from the main text and we go down to actual discussion of how it is being tested. So what happens is we sidestep and take a detour and discuss a question which may be relevant or may not be relevant because someone over the past has struggled with it, and we decide to, let's say, dedicate the other part of the class to a particular subject which may not necessarily fit within this framework. So, but basically, this is a framework which I designed to be part of the agenda for April 2016 lectures. And as we go through them, they will be gray. They will be shaded in gray, and this is how you may know where we're at. For example, let's say you decided to join somewhere over here, or you want to join over here. If you follow through, you will see that, okay, so this area is shaded, so Caribbean, the Caribbean Free Trade Agreement is something that you want to see being discussed in more details. This is when you can join. How do you join? One way to do that is to look at the class schedule. So, for example, November 15, 2016, and the way the classes will work, and I think that it fits best in terms of the work week, because a lot of people who prepare for the exam, they're also working individuals, so usually they have other commitments. So I think 6:30 to 8:30, and since I live in New York and those lectures will be in New York, I think this would be the best time, at least for those people who live on the East Coast. For the West Coast folks, or for the folks in Hawaii, it may not be the best, but at the same time, it will be. It is kind of like a compromise, which, because of its live format, will be able to be reached out all over the world, I say. So one way to do that is to register through the class schedule. As if you see if there is a date, the registration is not unlike many traditional schools. The registration will be per class basis. So if you don't have time because you have certain commitments, no need to register. If you have time and you'd like to attend, you're very welcome. There is two types of registration. The registration number one is online, and I'll talk a little bit about that shortly. And in person. In person is traditional. What happens is I welcome anyone during this time to come in here. Those lectures are being conducted out of my office. If there is more people, there is more space available. But basically, I designed it to be limited to small group. This is a relatively small office. But if the number grows, I may move it to, there is a lecture hall in the building, so I may move it down there. We'll see how it goes, all right? But basically anyone is, this office is located in JFK area. So a lot of folks who work in transportation and logistics industry are definitely welcome to attend, simply because a lot of folks that are in this industry, they are nearby. So that's always welcome. But if you can't, online situation is definitely the best option for you. So how will it work? So what you do is you go to online registration. The online registration can be done through several ways. Two ways are most popular. One way is to go to, there is a registration link, but there is the store button. And the store button, what it does is it allows you to go to live events, and you see the listing of live events over here, right? So for example, for November 15, 2016 event, which is the really the first class, you are welcome to register, and there is really no charge. It's kind of like everyone is welcome. I have limited to a number of people, although for online attendance, I think there is a limit. When I spoke with IT folks, there is a limit to like 1,000 people. So I think if we reach that limit, we're doing pretty good, but I do not know, we'll see. So what happens is you can reach it that way. Alternatively, on a schedule, class schedule, you can go to like online registration over here. And once you do the online registration, once you really started, you really have to go through this registration process. And let me say a few words about the registration process. So the way the registration works is it is asking you to use your name, provide your email, telephone number, etc., etc. And this is all relevant for business housekeeping in my end. But a lot of that information may not be relevant for the purposes of actually going online. And here is the reason why. So the platform that I'll be experimenting with is called Start Meeting platform. So startmeeting.com, I think would be, let's see, I think I mistyped. It's not Start Meeting, it's actually called Start Meeting. Let me change that. Okay. Let's close this. Let's start. Start Meeting. All right. So what happens is after you register, you'll be provided the link, but basically you'll be prompted to get the desktop app. And also for those folks who use those mobile devices, you can also do that over here. And once you log in, as you can see, you can look at several screens. One of the screens you will be able to look at is the camera. Another screen you'll be able to look at is the desktop. And you'll be able to switch between one and another very easily just by double tapping it. So I kind of like this feature, and I think it will be very useful for folks that use mobile devices. But for mobile devices, all you do is go to App Store and download that GoToMeeting app, as opposed to the desktop app if you use a PC. And all those instructions will be provided in 5-page or 7-page PDF pamphlet, which will be emailed to your right before the class or sometime around the time of registration. So once you download the desktop app, and I'm talking about PC users, what will happen is you'll be able to get to have those icons. So one is this icon, another one is this icon, and a third icon would be like the desktop icon. So this way you can really switch between the camera view and the desktop icon view. So those are the things that which you'll find useful, because it provides you audio and video synchronization. So dial-in number may remain the same, but once you download the app, keep in mind the access code and the PIN number and online meeting ID will change. So each registration will be different access code and will have a different online meeting ID. So it's important to keep those open. In other words, do not save them. And once you register, this is what it will look like. So right now I have three registrants available. So which Yuri Stariko, which is me, I'm a host, hello. You have John Doe, which is a known figure. And you have Peter Marg, which is another person who is kind of like a test person that is using one of the local computers. So, but basically that's the way it will look like. And I know some folks are shy of putting their name. I've known personally a gentleman, a very nice gentleman, and he was working in air export department, and he was a very good worker, but he always wanted to work in import, so he would come to classes and he would always look around and make sure that he's not very much known to learn customs, study for the customs broker license, because he didn't want to be perceived as leaving the air export department and moving into the world of imports. And as you know, licensed customs broker, at least the US version, the exam itself is mostly on the import side, not on the export side. So, and I understand that, and that's fine. So I'm not going to insist that you use your name. You can be John Doe, or you can call yourself Peter if you like. You can call yourself anything you want, as long as it's not offensive. So don't use bad words or derogatory words. What I will insist on is to use the email address that you registered with. If you prefer not to use, let's say, corporate address, but an address like from Gmail registration, that's fine. But as long as I see it, because what will happen is this is the way I can, me or my assistants can check to see if that person indeed registered or not. This is the way we can keep track and do the housekeeping on our end. So keep that in mind. You will be placed in what's called the attendance, in the lecture mode. And the lecture mode is pretty much where you will be muted from the start. And the reason you'll be muted from the start is because I've been through lots of webinars, those online meetings, and usually there is, and when the table is open to discussion, meaning the lines are open, there is always someone, especially when there is a large group of folks, someone taken away for whatever reason, let's say they need to step out, and they decide to put something on hold. Well, if you put something on hold, especially in a corporate environment, there is usually a music or some kind of like a commercial begins to play, and everyone is forced to enjoy that commercial. So what I do is I try to avoid that by putting mute as a default mode from the very beginning. And of course, this doesn't mean it has to stay that way, because what you can do on your end is you can always send a message either, let's say, to me, to everyone, or to someone who is there. And during various meetings, especially if there is a group of individuals who like to collaborate, this is a useful feature. Let's say I'm in the middle of something explaining how the custom stuff work, and there is a question, and I will try to get to the question, but someone knows the answer right away, so they may start a discussion that way without me even being involved. Of course, if I see something which is incorrect, I'll try to jump in to correct it sooner or later. And this way, it will be that type of collaboration, but sometimes it requires, for example, clarification because it's easier just to say by voice, which will give me an option to really unmute someone, and I can unmute someone that way. and have a discussion. Of course, those folks who are live here in class, they can just speak out. it's always fine. And conduct the discussion in a more traditional way. But since we are moving into the world of technology, the streaming technology, I think for now this would be the best option to have. All right, so that's about the online thing. So we talked about registration, we talked about online. Let me give a few words about the quality, because one of the most important things which I think must be adhered to is the ability to view. So for example, it looks kind of weird here, but what the way the meeting is designed is it's designed to give you the clear desktop view and a camera view. So in case I have to write something out, let's say I have to write CBE classification, and then let's say I do some kind of drawing and I put some kind of digits on the side, right? So whenever I do that, you may want to see this on the screen, because the only desktop option is available. And those folks who follow my lectures, they know that I use the whiteboard quite a bit. And this is when the screen comes handy. What can be done to increase the screen? Well, what you can do is you can move it up like this, and kind of like use this screen largeness as a way to comfortably view this. Those folks that have several screens, let's say they have one desktop with two monitors, they can break it up. Folks that use the tablets, they can double tap, and this way they can switch. So if I start drawing something on the board, you can immediately double tap and switch to the view, which is the camera view. But here is a problem, though, and I think it's important. While this is supposedly high definition, I think this is like 720, which is by some standards high def, I haven't, at least on the start meeting or many other webinar platforms, I'm not going to call the names, but I checked the most popular ones. I checked their adaptability, and I was not unable to get like really crispy view, if you will. By crispy, what I'm talking about like 1080p, which requires about 6k per second stream rate. So I haven't been able to get that this way. This is good enough, I think. And because it's synchronized, the video is synchronized with the presentation, I think this will be good enough. But I wanted to go a little bit beyond that. So what I've done is I prepared the presentation through the second camera also. And that second camera is designed to stream through the YouTube servers. So in fact, right now, as I speak right now, this presentation is being streamed live through YouTube. And let me pull up the YouTube screen. All right, so here it is. And if you like, you can take a look at the quality. So here you have 1080 HD quality, and you can see me here speaking about something which I've been speaking just a few seconds ago. The problem with YouTube is twofold. One thing is I would have loved to have done all my lectures over the YouTube because they provide such a high quality, but the terms of service do not allow me. I believe like paragraph 4A or something like that of the terms, they say you cannot charge for access to the YouTube video. So I said, okay, fine, YouTube. I tried to reach out to them. I tried to speak to them. How can I do this so I can comply with the terms of service? I wasn't able to get folks to respond to me in a meaningful way. They gave me some links, but those links pretty much was a closed end loop. So what I've done is I've done the follows. I'm gonna make this presentation, this YouTube stream, available publicly. In other words, anyone in the world can see me, can watch me doing the presentation live. And in fact, the live presentation links will be also provided through the website. By live presentation link, so let's say let me go to the let me move that start meeting icon to the different monitor. Let's see. So the class, this live classes page, right? This is this URL, right? Hyperlink. lawcustoms.com/CBE/live. Now, if you scroll down, you will always see the next lecture being embedded. So, for example, next class will be streamed through here. Once it starts, the video will start playing. There will always be other links which can be shared. But let me go back to that stream YouTube, which is currently being streamed live as I speak. Now, here is the problem with this one, and I haven't been able to deal with it effectively. And it's kind of annoying, but as you can see, what I've been speaking just maybe like 20 seconds ago is being currently played right now. So it's not synchronized. With Start Meeting platform, I was able to synchronize video and audio. So this way you will not get distracted. If you go to this one, you will get a high quality, but it will not be synchronized with audio. And in fact, you will not get any audio sound because those with the terms of YouTube service, and I always try to abide by the terms. I try to adhere to the conditions, and if I misunderstand something, I always try to ask. But so the audio portion will be a little bit backward, and of course, what you can do is let me get that startmeeting.com screen back again. So what you can do here is you can watch this through the stream. Oops. Let me get that out. So you can watch the YouTube through the stream, but you can dial in using just a regular phone. You can always use voice over IP if you have the technology, mics and speakers. And you can always do that in remotely in conjunction with YouTube, right? The problem is will be that delayed reaction. It can get kind of annoying because I may say something, but you will only see it sometime later. And usually the average delay response that I've seen is about 25 to 35 seconds. All right. So again, it may vary on the region, but that's what I have seen. So it may be quite significant, right? All right. So I think this pretty much covers what I wanted to say. So the main dedicated page will be over here. The updates and registration information So this is going to be the working page. So all this stuff, the schedule, it will be continuously updated. And as you can see, the classes will be running all the way up to the day of the exam. Most of them Tuesday, Thursdays. The schedule sticks 6:30 to 8:30 Eastern Standard Time. I will try to adhere to that schedule. I've done it before this way. It worked out pretty well for me and for those folks that attended. I hope it will work out this time. And hopefully that you will find this type of engagement useful and beneficial. So again, hope to see you join this class and hope to see to the future engagement as we dive into the another semester of licensed customs broker exam preparation. All right, see you.